Welcome to the Ordovician. I'm your host, a very old individual of Pikaia grasslands. I'm actually turning 35 million this year. However, while I personally might be the same, the species of the Cambrian have been evolving. Using the five categories that diverged in the Ediacaran, we have hard-bodied invertebrates, soft-bodied invertebrates, five-pointed invertebrates, kind of invertebrates, and yes, vertebrates. Where are they now in the Ordovician? To recap, ectyxozoans include the confusingly ordered lobopodians, which absorbed 8 of the 15 names I gave out in the last video. Including trilobite allies, they had an overwhelming majority of 11. Fortunately for everyone else, lobopodians are extinct by now. Well, not extinct, because technically most arthropods are lobopodians, but they're no named species. Also, Egrocassis in the very early Ordovician, but I arbitrarily picked the middle for this video. I guess Egrocassis can be the shovelhead bid, as suggested by a comment. Trilobites, fortunately, are up and kicking and have barely changed because they're perfect. So, in order, Asaphus is the bug-eyed amest, Isotelus is the mole amest, Calamine is the crescent amest, and Flexicalamine is the warped crescent amest, Elianus is the faceless amest, and Dalmanitina is the Dalmatian amest. I know that's not what it's named after, but also animal names are weird sometimes. Spiralians were useless nobodies sitting on the bottom of the ocean. However, after they realized being soft-bodied was not ideal, they did something about it, and then came to dominate the Ordovician, a group we'll have plenty of time with. We didn't have any echinoderms last time. This time, we will have plenty. Hemichordates were restricted to Diplograptus, the common clide, who's still here nowadays because Graptolites... we can also usher in Orthograptus, the straight hook clide, and finally early chordates. In the days of yesteryear, these were the dreads, Pikaia and its ilk. Since then, chordates have narrowed into vertebrates. What's the difference between the two? Well, besides nostrils, W-shaped myomeres, a two-chambered heart, and the division of the endoderm into a separate neural crest germ layer, the main thing is cartilage and the cranium. So, instead of the smooth, soft, and flexible Pikaia, we have...
Hey there! If you want to find my sunken treasure chest, you'll have to try better than that.
I'm the one that tells lies.
So Succobombastis is large and heavily armored. I mean, it's no Dunkelosteus, but it's almost 10 inches long. That's twice as big as Pikaia was. It still has no jaw or teeth, its tail is more pronounced, but most importantly, its name, the name of most early vertebrates, and the name of its taxon, all reference its hard skin, so that's going to be where the name comes from. So, geography? Well, half of Europe is on the subcontinent of Baltica, notably England and Saxony are down here in Avalonia, and the Mediterranean is part of Gondwana down at the South Pole. Succobombastis was found in temperate Gondwana, so maybe we could construct a range like this. That being the case, I'm betting on Arabic via Spanish like alcohol, lime, and jar. Now, the two main roots for shell are kashara, peel, rind, eggshell, and slud the fa for seashell, or also chance. The double meaning makes me want to use the eggshell option, plus the fact that Maclur is nicer than Mazduf. Anyway, yes, the peeled, or in this case, the one who has a shell, is Al-Maqshur, Spanish Al-Maqshur, potentially French Almager, English Almager, or Halmager. So, Succobombastis is the Greater Almager, Arandaspis is the Australian Almager, and Astraspis is the Necessary Almager, based on the specific epithet of its type species. Now, 10 inches may seem impressive, but the giant of the day was Endoceras, at over twice the size of Succobombastis. More specifically, close to 35 times the size, but let's not split hairs. The giant in a horn was previously seen in the best Latin name section, and it's representative of the Nautiloids, a group of shelled cephalopods. Endoceras is hard to miss, so it's pretty much anywhere we look. That being the case, we'll call it the Grabber, Piaikarpos, referencing the ambush predator style. This is the type 3 Greek noun carps, genitive carbos, and Latin herbus. And the Germanic doesn't matter because it gets replaced for being taboo. So the new form used in Germanic is the hidden one, or skewo, which becomes skewo in Proto-Germanic into shewa in Old English and shoe in Modern English. Alternatively, the Norse form undergoes Holtzmann's Law, and it becomes skegwo and English skeg, with the adjective being herbine either way. So Endoceras is the colossal skeg, Orthoceras is the giant skeg, and Plectronoceras is the shielded skeg. So, what was that I said earlier about echinoderms? Well, the ancestors of starfish have some unique lifestyles going on, notably facehuggers. The paracrinoids are only one member of the blastozoans, which we'll get to later. For now, they're found in Baltica and the United States, notably the Ohio River Valley, so I'll give them a Shawnee name. I'm partial to something like sea hand on some level because my Shawnee dictionary is limited. It gives me leche for hand. I think we'll just drop the C. This might be received via French, in which case it becomes leche and is pronounced leche in English. Otherwise, it becomes lechy in English. I only have one example, so amygdalocystites is the waving lechy. So I guess we cycle back to arthropods now. Like I said, lobopodians are dead in the water. But, I mean, if they're dead in the water, well, probably, but all we have are trace fossils, so we can't name anything specifically. But not all trilobites are conforming. The Agnostids must have noticed bilateral symmetry is very valuable, and they decided to double down on it. This is seriously what they look like. They were found worldwide, even in polar regions like France, so they'll probably be native Indo-European. Using some root for equal or balance, we get loige, the same root as alike in English, which is Proto-Germanic laiko, and Old English lakmu, and Modern English loke. Sorry, this is very second nature to me at this point, potentially shortened by analogy to lake or loch, but not in this case. So Trinitus is the blind loke, and Garagnostis is the familiar loke. But doesn't Agnostis actually mean unfamiliar? Well, here's the sugar on the cream. You're all a bunch of goy cattle, so shut up. So over to the spiralians again. Brachiopods are a thing, but they're so similar to modern-day brachiopods, they hardly deserve a new name. Of course, brachiopods isn't exactly a common name. Lampshell has kind of fallen out of fame, so with that in mind, Plesiomys is the Pacific laureate lampshell, and Platystrophia is the Asian laureate lampshell. No idea what laureate is supposed to indicate. Maybe it's a corruption of aureate, which is golden. Circling back to hemichordates, we're still a part of the graptolites, yes, but these ones have different shapes as opposed to the medusoid clides. Didymograptus was the largest, with colonies similar in size to early vertebrates. These were more kelp-shaped, like sea tweezers. I can't imagine these are as pressing as some of the larger, more mobile creatures of the day, so I'll keep the name from Greek. Notably, the word for that which drifts is already planet in English, and that which is carry is way too close to phenomenon. However, that which is drifting is planon, which is free, as is planazon, that which has drifted. Of course, these are switched over to Latin endings, as is customary when naming things, becoming planum and probably English plane. So maybe throw in a prefix, something like paraplane for it drifts around, or simplane for it drifts together, referencing the two lobes. So Climacograptus is the one-winged simplane, and Didymograptus is the two-winged simplane, and Pterograptus is the flowering simplane. So over to more echinoderms, we have the Edrioasteroids. I'm not entirely sure what these look like because the Ordovician is not kind to me, but I think they're basically blobs with a starfish drawn on, so I'm just gonna really cover my bases with five-armed from another language, especially since they were found in Morocco. The Arabic name for that thing on the Moroccan flag is Muhammas Najma, with this part meaning star, so something like Spanish Naja Najama, English Najama. So Lepidodiscus is the scaly Najama, Carniella is the slender Najama, and Isorophis is the American Najama. Am I not giving these enough time? Who cares? It's Edrioasteroids. No one even knows their scientific names, let alone common names. Whatever, let's do something people actually know about. Eurypterids, aka sea scorpions, are the closest we have to extant lobopodians in this era. The form they've settled on is a long, thin body covered in protective scales, two grabby arms, two lobe-looking things coming out the back, and several frilly legs decorating the face area. Most comparable in form to the paramps, but they're their own thing. One could argue sea scorpion is already a common name. One could also shut the heck up and let me have my fun. Sea scorpions were found pretty much worldwide, so we could go with a native Old English name, the PIE word for dark, which seems like a pretty fair guess to start with no matter what its coloration ends up being, is them with eh, as an ending. Brrr, Proto-Germanic thamo, Old English thamu, English thame. Maybe fame just doesn't do it justice, actually. Let's look at Latin. After all, scorpion and lobster are both from Latin. Also, they did a lot more interesting things than just having a dark coloration. In fact, they were probably some of the first to begin the journey onto land. So how about something like someone who disappears for a long period of time and then just mysteriously reappears? Is there a word for that? Well, phantom and revenant are already taken. But who cares? Revenant is a cool name. So Pentacopterus is the giant revenant, Megalograptus is the yawning revenant, Brachiopterus is the lesser revenant, and Echinognathus is the spiny revenant. Next up is back to the vertebrates with this freaky little fellow. What's important to know about conodonts? They branched off before the ostracoderms, and for a long time, the only fossils we had of them were teeth. Relevantly, nothing else had teeth at this time. Again, they're found worldwide, so let's aim for Norse. Anyway, I have an idea for something like tooth ward, paralleling the etymology of steward, lord, and some names. In Old Norse, this is tonvurlur, loaned as Old English tonward. Influence from towards or forward could yield something like tonward, but I think the most likely is a silent W and short vowel, yielding tonard, similar to Greenwich or Southwark, but spelled accordingly. So, Baltoniotis becomes the Baltic tonard, Amorphognathus is the lion tonard, and Pigatus is the goosefoot tonard. So, what are we missing? Nothing super important. I'm sure some random Ordovician specialist who cares about, like, Maclurites or something is upset that I skipped their favorite, so we'll round it up to 15. So, what is Maclurites? It's a snail. Now, some snails have unique names, especially sea snails like whelks and periwinkles, which may or may not be the only two examples, so I will actually give them a name instead of just snail. Now, Maclurites are mostly found in the modern-day Appalachians. This very old set of mountains has already partially formed, but not the Adirondacks part. So, Ganyangeha or Mohawk has a word for snail, which is Dzo Niskarotare. Niskarot? No. No, the T is voiced because it comes before a vowel, even if it's part of the cluster Hut. Yes, actually, so Niskarod. Maclurites is the Appalachian Niskarod. Alright, let's finish off the echinoderms with the rest of the Blastozoans. Basically, they look like feathery and sort of like a stock jellyfish. Actually, not really, now that I pulled up a photo. Whatever. It's another group that was found most abundantly in the Middle East. Actually, if you recall, the Najamas are part of them. But my point is, I'll do an Arabic name, Arabic via Persian. So we start with Avestani. Avestani pancha bazunam, which is exactly cognate with English five bows. It means the five-armed one, in Avestani, which is the language they speak, in Avestan, which is the land of the birds. Famously, Arabic does not have a p consonant, so it receives something like fanslabaz or fanjabaz. Z is respelt to s, which is reinterpreted as a plural, so we get singular fansaba, plural fansabaz. I don't really have an example besides Diploporita being the swollen fansaba. Reef builders are a vague class of animals you sometimes see referenced, including some prehistoric corals and bryozoans. Notably, corals haven't really changed that much, so the name coral is probably still fine, and bryozoans don't even have a common name nowadays, but whatever. Tabulate Coral was the main man of the Ordovician, notably Tetradiids, and we haven't had a chance to actually do China, so let's do that. And by China, I of course mean Malaysia, because there are actually next to no animal names loaned from Chinese. Now, the name Tabulate, and actually one of the most notable things about coral, is them being very table grid shape. The word penulae is the word for gridiron, although a hexagonal grid, potentially something involving bees, could be more accurate to the shape. Also, penulae uses the same prefix peng as in peramp, which I don't love, so Malay laba, English laba, presumably through Singapore, and I have no examples of that group. Okay, I think I'm gonna take a break from this video topic. I have some other ideas, probably. Also, I am taking 17 credits this semester, so maybe I'll just go on hiatus. Who's to say?
She called me Saka Bambas, please tell me fantastic, touch me on.